Okay, good morning everyone. A very happy 2017 to all of you. So we are kickstarting this year with a very distinguished visitor from CMU, Professor Eswaran Subrahmanian. He's a research professor at this Engineering Research Accelerator and Engineering and Public Policy departments at CMU in Pittsburgh. His work spans engineering design, information modeling for collaborative engineering work, role of standards for product lifecycle management, engineering and policy, and systems engineering for collaborative work. He has worked with a number of companies like ABB, Bosch, Boeing, Bombardier, etc. He has also been a guest researcher at NIST, National Institutes for Standards and Technology in the US, a visiting professor at DU Delft, University of Lyon, and is a distinguished visiting fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering in UK. He's also a distinguished scientist of the ACM, fellow of the American Association of Advancement of Science. Incidentally, has also co-founded a company here in Bangalore called
Future of Non-profit.
A non-profit entity, so he keeps visiting Bangalore periodically, and hopefully we'll have more interactions with the center and the institute as we go forward. So with this, I'll hand over the desk.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. What I'm going to talk about today, Happy New Year to all of you. Sorry, I should have started with that. And what I'm going to talk about to you is actually placing a lot of cyber-physical systems in context and the kind of problems that we need to address, both from a standards point of view and also from a foundational point of view. So my outline will be to start with some notion of terminology of how we see the space of cyber-physical system in a social context. And then this project called Downtown DC, which is a trash collection example. I also have another example based on time. We can look at it later. And the need for standards and how do we deal with semantic interoperability in systems like cyber-physical systems. So to start with, I'll start with the cyber-physical systems terminology. In general, what we are dealing with is the physical world, which is manifests itself in the form of the environment, physical networks, things, and persons. And now we are sensing these things and connecting them to form what we call Internet of Things. So I'm going to build this block as we go along. And now when you have them interconnected systems in control, this is what we are thinking in terms of cyber-physical systems. Here, primarily, it's the connection of the information world to the physical world through the internet and through computational means. Now, a simple example is a hospital room where everything is being monitored and different things, the room temperature, HVAC, patient condition, all of those things are monitored through the internet for someone to monitor the patient. So you can think of this as a basic unit of a cyber-physical system. And of course, all of you have seen this picture of Google car, which is also set in the environment as part of the cyber-physical world. So now, here is the physical and the cyber world. Now here we have the society itself in terms of formal social organization, informal organization, and individual people. Now these two interact with each other in a very interesting ways. Right? The first way they interact is through formal institutional structures. I'll come to that later. For example, if you think of even your DigiCash, right? There are certain things, you have the phone, you're able to take pictures or whatever and exchange cash, but it is going through a very complicated institutional structure called bank or certain types of banks. They all have to interact with this world. So what they are doing is they are sensing different things. How are different organizations connected? What are the data they are collecting? And they are fine-tuning their operation with respect to how they are interacting with this work. Now, I'll push the hospital example. Now, what you have are multiple CTSs, which are being administered through the process of the hospital structure. Their responsibilities and agencies become important. What I mean by agency is who is responsible for making what decision. There are certain decisions you may be making here and certain decisions you're making here. You need to figure out where the balance between these two decisions are, and that is what I mean by agency. Who is the agent who is responsible for making a particular decision, whether it is cyber or people? So you need to have this sense very clearly identified. Now let's make this a little bit more complicated, right? Now what if you take a hospital, you have operating theaters, medical records, staffing, scheduling, drugs, and all of these things are getting connected. And what you have are multiple cyber physical systems which are connected with the decision-making process of the hospital itself. Some of it doesn't work today because the medical records are not standardized, certain other things are not standardized, or they are getting standardized over time. Now let's make it a little bit more complicated. Now you have a hospital network, and you have a transportation network, and you have patients. You could have a single ambulance scheme actually doing all this and all of this. And I'll give you an example that is being done in University of Arkansas. They have a telemedicine, and believe it or not, in Arkansas, there is only one neonatal specialist for the entire state. And if you think we are third world, there are third world pieces in America too. And what they did was they created a network where they had centers which were distributed around the state, and there were additional local centers in the villages or towns. So if there was a neonatal issue, they would bring the person to the intermediate center where there was a communication between the neonatologist and the specific person who they had an ultrasound and video conferencing available. And once they did that, if someone needed emergency help or certain types of help which is not available, they had a centralized transportation clearance system, which allowed them to move the patient from the local hospital to the next nearest best care availability. So this whole structure is operating for the last 10 years. I'm taking this example just to provide a broader context. Yes, please. Yeah.
Questions in the middle?
Yeah, sure.
So this is, there are two ways you can do this. One is, of course, you can formalize it. You can design it top down.
Yeah.
Another thing is you can decide that these things keep growing.
Yeah.
Because a new hospital is built or the hospital structure changes. Yeah. Hospital itself grows.
Yeah.
So then you can have a kind of a more or less informal
Absolutely.
Model where you can integrate this on the fly.
Right.
Which means that, of course, makes it a little bit more complex.
Yeah.
There are system integration issues involved. The other thing also is the network, because you have to reserve certain bandwidth.
Yeah.
These are critical applications.
Yeah.
I mean, in my company, we do a lot of work on network slicing precisely for that.
Yeah.
It is to ensure that you can slice a part of the network, ensure that certain minimum bandwidth is available.
Absolutely.
You're talking about, you know, sending video images to the remote neonatal guy, right? So that will require certain dedicated bandwidth, it should not be interfered by other communication systems. So that also needs to...
No, absolutely. I'm not going into all the details of the network part, but different contexts may require different configuration of what you're talking about. In the case of Arkansas, doing a centralized was the best way to get to the the rural areas in a systematic way. But in other places, it must be very different, right? When you have the infrastructure, when you have connecting different hospital versus connecting one hospital to a range of other centers is another way of thinking about it. Okay. So now we created an idea of how cyber organizational networks connect to the cyber physical system, and now you have cyber social networks. Now what is happening here, you have informal social organizations. Your Facebook, Twitter, all of these things are informal social organizations. And they themselves are scanning and sensing things, and so that's why we call it sort of Internet of People and interconnected social networks. Now the thing is, this is also enormous amount of data is coming through this process. So that is interacting with your cyber organizational network. For example, what is happening is companies mining Twitter data to figure out what to do. Is that interaction from here to here? I'm just giving you a sparse example, but you can imagine how Twitter or Facebook or you, even your interaction in the blogs and so on could also play a significant role in providing information. In fact, there are sites called patients like me, which are really patients of a particular disease coming together and exchanging information. And that is being mined by hospitals to figure out correlations which they did not anticipate, especially with respect to drug effectiveness. Because now we know more and more that if you, when you do randomized controlled trials, you're actually targeting the average population and not the personal population, and people react to drugs in different ways. But here is another source of information to understand who's having different kinds of interaction. So if you think of this, if you really want an entire smart system society, you not only need the cyber-physical part, you need the organizational part and the social part. These things to be integrated in some fashion, because all of them have different kinds of data and different processes working with them. It's this interplay between them that is going to make the system what you want it to be, whether you want it to be resilient, robust, all of those questions can be asked within this perspective. Now, Now I'll talk a little bit about this project I have with downtown DC. The city has been divided into several what they call eco-districts. One of them is downtown DC. It's 90 blocks. It's right around the Capitol, and all the buildings around that region is has been designated as downtown DC. Now here, to realize some of the ideas I talked about, we are attempting this example where, let me give you the overall challenge. The management is to clean, walkable city, reliable operation. These are your expectations from the downtown project. However, we want to manage watering of plants and removal of garbage from the city. The problem now is the way the contracts are set. Every day, certain trucks follow the same route, whether the garbage can is full or not. And so, can we change the dynamics by introducing sensors into the garbage can, which can measure the fullness of the garbage can and accordingly send the right message? Along with it, we also are collecting data by the people who are actually driving the trucks to take photographs. And we have created something called a microblog, and I'll show you a little bit. But all they have to do is to take a picture when they are picking up. So if it was expected to be full, then it was only half. So you're starting to collect data on the rate of filling of garbage cans in different parts of the city. Not only that, Washington DC has this mall, which is like the India Gate to Presidential Palace kind of thing. On either side is our Smithsonian, and they have a lot of events. For example, a few years ago, they recreated the Silk Road in the mall with little stalls to give you an impression of that. Those events create huge amounts of garbage. These are surge conditions which happen not on a daily basis, but on an event basis. In the winter it is less, in the summer it's more. So that means you have to have different service routing, and then you have to have situational awareness, and then you also have a multi-objective resource optimization problem. So the goal of this public space waste management system, the downtown DC people really got a lot of citizen input, and then to mobilize various sections of the society to say, hey, we need to move towards a sustainable society. And some of the relevant goals are zero waste plan, ban polystyrene, decrease citywide waste rate, and increase recycling. Because we also want to find out whether people are putting the plastic things in the wrong container, so that then maybe you need some instruction to say, hey, don't put it here, you know, additional messages to be sent to people. Not only are we interested in that, it's important that when I collect trash, if I minimize the amount of trips, I have surplus labor, which is available if you have the same amount of labor, but the same garbage trucks also water the plants. So they do it in two different trips. Can we combine these two things, or can we allocate labor in such a way that we use the sensors and the predictive structures as a way to actually manage both labor use as well as efficient trash collection? So here is where both the institutional and the actual physical system come into play. This is work I'm doing with Professor Ramesh Jain of University of California, Irvine, and I'll tell you a little bit more about it. So what we have now are trash bin sensors. We already have some data on about 100 trash bins. And we have started testing what we call micro reports, which is being built by a small company in California. And that allows you to create micro blogs. The problem with Twitter is very high noise. You cannot trust many things. So we believe that you have to have specialized apps, or eventually maybe a city app where you say, I'm talking about garbage, or I'm talking about potholes or whatever, right? But for now, what we have is a micro reporting system whereby individual citizens can take photographs, and you have the location, and you have the filling of the amount of garbage, all of which is actually combined together spatially into the real-time situation. I will say a little bit about Event Shop. Event Shop is an interesting piece of open source software. What it does is it takes a lot of data streams, and I have a data streams, and it allows you to have different kinds of operators. So it has an algebra to connect these, using these filters to actually produce a spatio-temporal map of the current state of affairs. Now, this gives us the data about what is happening. Now, what do we need to do next is, can we use that to predict based on event history? Now, in this case, usually it fills up to 70%, but it has already filled up to 90% at this time. So I can project that this might fill faster, and so I don't need to wait till 10 o'clock, but actually something is happening earlier, which could be brought in. Right? So this is the downtown area, and then in this area is where we are doing this. So this could, again, allow you to potentially predict the filling of the trash cans. So you already have the current sensors and the current state of the other trash cans, and you predict them and use that as a way to do the routing. So this is actually Event Shop. So you have a data stream, you have certain operators to combine them, and you can define a whole situation in terms of this. The way I see it is that city is a multi-state change machine, continuous multi-state change machine. And it's not completely predictable, it has its own logic. However, if you can isolate certain areas, let us say garbage collection as one area, it can have its own independent event streams and operate within that. Transportation can operate with its own event stream. So what you do is you take the event streams and situations corresponding to one set of tasks first. So once that is done, now let us say I want to route something, but I need to find out the current transportation state, so that whether I should do the routing right now or wait for half an hour when the traffic will be less, where I can use the trucks to go pick it up.
Yes.
So is this akin to complex event processing?
Yeah, it's very complex. Yes, it is complex event processing.
Okay.
What he has done, interestingly, is that all the data streams have geospatial location also, and so he translates everything into a spatio-temporal map.
Ah, okay.
Okay. Which makes it a lot more easier doing a lot of things. Okay, if you want, I'll talk to you later about, he's also using it for informing, I'm working with him on informing people about pollution and asthma.
Okay.
Okay, please stop me, any of you will. So our approach is this. We have Crumbs, which is our microblogger, which provides information. We have the sensors, and there may be other data streams which we can use. We take all of that, and you have a rule engine and alerts here, and then the image generator, and you create the visual analytics. Now, I can find out what the micro reports are, current GIS data, event data, and then I can take the route information as a way to actually plan today's truck routes. And this can be dynamically changed during the day as well. Right? So the idea is that not only data technology and analytics, we will also be able to manage the labor. And given this model, we can react to situations relatively fast. If you have a surge conditions, I will send more trucks there, knowing there may not be in other places. Yes, please.
So for the data fusion from different data streams, does Event Shop also have a way to calibrate the data coming in from different streams, or is that something that has to be done?
That has to be done by the implementer in that context, because it's not easy to figure out all the data stream, the veracity of the data, all kinds of things. So those are the kind of things you have to actually pay attention to. So we could add a certain amount of uncertainty into the whole thing, but if you don't know where the uncertainty is going to come from, then you're going to be a little bit of a problem in terms of actually implementing. See, that is why I'm glad you brought it. That's why I started with saying from cyber physical, when you start expanding, all of these issues become more and more, like his issue of networks,
right.
All of these things become very critical in terms of how they work together. And we need to think about it. Otherwise, we end up with pieces of technology which don't integrate with the functioning of the city. Okay, this is our team. Scott is the person from downtown DC, and then we have people from Department of Energy, and Professor Ramesh Jain, and Dhananjay and Ram from. So you can see we have different companies and different people working together. Now, a lot of these things are impossible if we don't have very good standards, and this is a major problem, because if you look at standards in the IoT space, it's not only very fragmented, it is also controlled by different groups in different countries. There is the European effort, there's the American private effort, so all of these things are going to create more confusion rather than in dealing with these problems. So if I were to take this quote, you could do a domestic machine with a toaster, and then you double the size, addition of a coffee pot, then IETF, assign coffee pot to its own specific standard, and so on. You can see at every stage, the standards are going to be very, very critical. Because a network doesn't work if you don't have standards. Your internet works because there is a standard for exchange. And in fact, there is a nice piece of work which says that decentralization was possible because centralization of protocol took place. So we have to be very conscious that if you're going to build systems which are going to be connected in a network sense, their benefit will come, the network effect, as economists call, will come only if the standards are there for smooth flow. Thereby, more and more people will join because they see the benefit in joining the structure itself. So there, it becomes very important. So you can see, device, network, successful adoption of standards is very, very important, and that has to be network agnostic for it to be functional. Now, this is the technology landscape. You can't see everything, but there are so many companies involved in various aspects of this. I reduced it a little bit to fit, and I lost the resolution, but that's okay. And that is your technology landscape. Some of them are on networks, some of them are on devices, and a whole range of something. still a ton of time. Okay, that's fine. So the other part of it is, again, if you look at standards, there's a whole variety of standards. This is by sector. This is transportation, it is industrial, energy. These are your sectors, and each of these sectors, there are certain demands, and those themselves require certain set of standards. And all of these have to be developed, or we have to come to consensus on what kind of standards we want to have in each of these sectors with the sector people in such a way that these things can interoperate. If not, what we'll have is actually even more isolated systems, because people will start relying on their internal system and won't communicate, which they, if they do now, that will also disappear. So there are disruptions that will take place by the introduction of these systems. So we need to have standards in a very... So there are a lot of standards bodies at the international level. You have IEEE, you know, ISO and IEC, IETF, W3C, those guys are doing a set of standards. And then the US counterpart is you have ANSI, which doesn't do standards, which only facilitates the development of standards by different groups. There is a big distinction in standards between Europe and US. A lot of standards are coordinated centrally much more by the standards groups in Europe, whereas the National Institute of Standards does not create standards, helps in creating standards, and ANSI is a body which allows you to facilitate the development of standards.
What about this OCF that's coming up now?
Yeah, that's yet another one.
It's not there.
Yeah, I might have missed
it. I think OIC is now become part of OCF.
That's correct.
They're not converging towards the OCF.
Yeah, keeping track of these changes sometimes is hard. But I just thought I would give an impression of the complexity of the problem we are facing in terms of
being... And the IEEE standard still hasn't been released as far as...
No, it hasn't.
It's still a work in progress.
Quite a few of them are in work in progress. Even if you take this out, the industry net 4.0, that's another whole set of standards for the manufacturing side,
right,
which is coming too.
It's more a slogan even at this stage.
you said it. Okay. So, from a more organizational point of view, these are the different organizations which are involved in this. Yeah, it's open, technical, and original. So, how are we going to get all these different standards effort work together? Because they may not be able to talk to each other, then you have another Tower of Babel which you have to deal with. Just to give you an idea, just in mechanical systems, you can see the number of standards. From ideation all the way to disposal, there are really a whole range of standards. Eventually, we may end up having this collection of standards coming from the mechanical side, electrical side, network side, device side. All of these things have to come together. Now, this is some work we are doing at NIST, and the people involved are a mathematician and a couple of other people who are engineers, and we are interested in looking at the foundations for interoperability. Traditionally, some of you may have done AI. There were all of these standards called KIF and then OWL for using ontology as a way for exchanging standards. That's one way of thinking about it, but we want to think about it in a context in which everything is changing. It's not a context where everything is stable. Certain things are stable, certain other things are changing, and so we should be able to compose them in different ways. Now, if you want to look at semantics for in sensor networks, you may have the semantics in the cloud, which where you may say, I'm going to put all the information in terms of ontologies and other things, and everything will be resolved from here. Or you can have semantics at the edge, which means each one has its own semantic structure. Somehow you have to make them interoperate. Both these require standards. One, you have standardized something so that everybody is using it. And the other one, different people are using different standards, but you have to connect them in some fashion. But not everything can be cloud-based. Not everything may be distributed. So you might have mixed systems, in which case we still face the problem of semantic interoperability and clarity in semantics. If you look at information modeling requirements. Incidentally, when I worked with Bosch and other people, we actually did ethnographic studies of how people actually use representations and what are the kind of models do they use, where do they combine them, how do they use them. So we have come up with these set of things. One, there has to be some way of constructing models. As you see, in each discipline, there are domain-specific languages. They are nothing but modeling languages for particular purposes. So you have model construction and the ability to represent things across scales. For example, we are working with materials people where we are helping them combine very early stages from the atomistic level to the molecular level to the microstructure level to the macro level, because they are all based on different theories and there are different simulation packages, which means they are operating at different scales. We need to figure out how to combine them so that eventually we can even build design materials for specific purposes once we have these things connected. But also in the smart city, you're going to have scales. You're going to have the sensor level, you have the decision-making level, and the inter-service interaction level. So you have these different levels at which you're using a lens into the city at different levels of its aggregation and operation. So they also have to be integrated in some fashion. And you should be able to accommodate broad set of formalism. Some things are based on different, you can model them in terms of differential equation, some as stochastic systems, some as discrete event systems. So what you have is all of these systems have their own internal formalism, which is what causes the interoperability problem. So because I use certain set of variables, in my case you use another one, you use a different time frame, all of these things have to be somehow put together, and that is the challenge in terms of integration and aggregation. But you also want to separate domain specific concerns as much as possible. In all of these, model evolution has to take place because you have new versions, new ways of doing things, so you'll have to pay attention to how models are going to evolve, and if I change them, what are the effects of it on the other models, and how do I deal with it? Lastly, last two, flexibility and modularity and scalability. In order for something like cyber-physical system to work as well as to be tested, we need to actually deal with all of these things in the short term as well as the long term. And how are we going to do is the question. One approach is encode domain knowledge using ontologies, which is what I mentioned earlier. That is to have a single ontology, which says I have a thing, a collection, spatial thing, temporal thing, and you start using the upper ontology and the domain ontology underneath and use this as your negotiating means. But the problem here, one of the problems here is all of this language has to be standardized so that everybody is using the same language and mean the same thing when they interact with each other. So what you have, if you think about the standards I showed you have your relational model. And then you go up,
you have RDF and other things, and then you have thesaurus and RDF, and then you have your logical theories, description logic, OWL, and model logic, and all of those. So what is happening is if you go along this, you're actually making it more expressive. The more expressive you have, you make it, then you get into other problems, computability problems, because it's not easy to have theorem provers for a very large set of systems. You can have it for small systems, and how do you deal with that? So this entire spectrum has to be covered, because already there are things using these different standards in terms of communication. So what we started doing is, what kind of mathematics do we need to solve this problem? Traditionally, first order logic or all things like that have been used to ensure semantics. It was our contention that those set of mathematics are not sufficient to deal with this problem. So we started looking at a mathematics called category theory, which was developed in the 1940s by MacLean and Sanders. And the idea of category theory was to create a formalism which will combine algebraic topology and geometry, so that they have a meta language to connect the two formalisms. What happened for a very long time, category theory was treated as abstract nonsense even by mathematicians. And later on, only in the 60s, late 60s and 70s, Birstall and Gauguin and others started using category theory for type theory in programming languages. If you go programming languages like ML, Haskell, if you have heard of those languages, they are all based on strongly typed languages which have roots in category theory, because type theory is very easily expressible in category theory. So, most semantic models are based on formal logic and set theory. This is mostly sufficient. Logical models are usually less relevant in systems analysis and behavior. Other relevant classes of semantics include statistical models, geometry, dynamic systems, and so on. So we are exploring the use of category theory as a flexible foundation for representing, analyzing, and interlinking this broader class of semantics. All of this started because my original project on collaborative engineering, during the study, we realized what was happening with information models and how engineers construct these information models in situ, on demand. When they need it, they create them. And then the problem of interlinking becomes an integral question of that. So it was clear. It was clear that only using logic was not sufficient. Only using different formalisms by themselves were not sufficient. What we needed is a way to interconnect the different formalisms themselves. For example, if I make a design change, I want to find out what is going to happen in the manufacturing of that particular part. Will it be affected? How will it be affected? So, which means not only do I have to have the product structure, I have to have the process structure, I have to have a design specification. When I tweak it, I have to jump different formalisms, and then I may be doing a simulation using dynamic systems. So that whole process of designing is jumping across multiple formalisms and connecting them. This is how engineers work. And we often don't think about it in those terms, but that's how they work. If that is the case, pure logic won't work. So about 15 years ago, I realized that we have to go to a different mathematics, and category theory would be a potential application. And the notion of constructive mathematics, I'll come to that a little bit later, could be a useful way of thinking about it. However, when I read the first book, I couldn't understand head or tail of it. Of category theory, because it is quite abstract. It takes, you have to shift your head a little bit upside down to flip up to a different level to see how you can translate all of it. So when after I spent 4 years in India, when I went back, I started spending time at NIST, and this problem of CPS became more critical, and we said, oh, we should find a way to do it.
And then we found this person, David Spivak at MIT. He has a paper called O-Logs, where he created a graphical representation by which you can create the underlying conceptual model using category theory. So we contacted him, we started working with him, and the first project we did was to integrate two material databases coming from completely different spaces and integrate them so that there will be a single way to do it. But databases and category theory go closely. You can create a categorical model and actually map it into an SQL database more or less directly. Okay. So not only that, matrices are representable within category theory, graphs, dynamical systems, stochastic systems, and so on. This work is just starting to pick up. There's a person called John Bias. I found out he happens to be the cousin of the famous singer John Bias. And he is taking Petri nets and modeling them using certain categorical structures called symmetrical monoidal categories, and taking chemical reactions. So slowly people are taking different formalisms and starting to model them in category theory. And once you are in category theory, you have enormous amount of advantages. You can map between categories, and there is category of categories. It's a self-reflexive mathematics, which allows you to do all kinds of things which you cannot do in traditional mathematics and combine. So can category theory be the calculus of information? Language for representing mechanical states, processes is what Newton's calculus provided a collection of standard techniques and algorithm. Then similarly, predicate calculus does the same thing for logic and lambda calculus in computation. CT is a calculus of abstract processes which generalize all three of these contexts. So this provides us an enormous amount of power, but not a lot of people know category theory. And we have had problems getting our papers published saying we can't find reviewers. So we have to tell them which reviewers to send, and slowly we are starting to get people to review. Okay. What we think category theory provides, my colleague Spencer Briner calls it providing hygiene. What he means by that, but when you are creating a model, category theory imposes certain restrictions. That is, you have objects and arrows, and the arrows have to signify one-to-many or injective relationship in set theoretic sense, so that all relationship are of a particular functional type. I'll give you a simpler example. When you have many-to-many relationship in databases, relational databases, you break it and create an intermediate key to connect the two, so that everything is a function from one table to the other table to the other. So if you think in those terms, set theoretic terms, they are functions between two different objects. Because category theory is a mathematics of structures. It's not a mathematics of objects. It has objects and arrows, and that's how you construct a particular category. And then you have other operators I'll come to in a second. So if you look at it from another point of view, you have from less to more expressive. Can category theory span this in the way that we can model all of these things at the categorical level and combine them to do the kind of interoperability we can do? Okay, if you want to know more about ontology, you can go to this ontology subreddit. Now that I have identified the notion that we need to worry about semantics, and ontology is one way, now let's look at interoperability. If you see, this is the dream, right? You have common models, explicit models, then you have self-describing systems, and ending up with self-integrating systems. But we are quite far away from there. We have some notion of self-describing systems and agent-based models in a very limited way, but we are nowhere here in terms of self-integrating systems, because this is a big bottleneck. Having good semantics will allow you to have better description, and better description will allow you to integrate systems in a systematic way. Okay, now, in an ideal world, you will share one universal vocabulary, but it doesn't happen. Often, you have different vocabularies used by different people. So even people who build ontologies using OWL and so on, they have the problem of what they call ontology integration or ontology merger, where you have all of this notion of namespaces and how you deal with them, all of those questions come about. Whereas, so we should create a V, which is a combination of P and Q, but it should be able to encompass the client ontologies. They have to maintain consistency. Size and complexity may be a barrier to entry. The approach requires widespread agreement on the choice of V. That means you have to have a common vocabulary to which you can map everything. Instead of vocabularies, what if we build bridges? Okay. So we have one set representing P with its own terminology and language, and there is another one, which is Q, and then you want to build a bridge between them. You can say, oh, okay, I can create a functional mapping of some sorts, but there are better ways to do it in category theory. So they are called functors. Functors are mappings across categories. So I'm giving you a very simple example because it can get quite complicated very quickly. Let us say P has these two terms. Extrusion, boss extrusion is an extrusion. Whereas there is another database in which you have extrusion is a boss extrusion is an extrusion, and base extrusion is one, and boss extrusion has base extrusion as a parent. Now I could create a map saying this extrusion is the same as this extrusion, and boss extrusion is the same as this. In this case, we have imported Q imports P in the way it is interconnected. Please stop me. However, what is beautiful about it, I can have my own namespace on this side, I can have my own namespace on this side, as long as I can map these two together. Map the right terms to the right terms. So one example of translation is we have an application and we have another application which is in one particular language called PSRL, don't worry about that. And then the other application has its own, and what you want is to be able to take something from here, connect it, and then send it back. And often this common semantics is also written in PSRL because both are in PSRL. But what if they are in two different structures? Is also the question we want to deal with. So, not only that, it's very interesting that when I have one database, one structure, and I have another structure, but this structure is much more elaborate. Actually, I can get all the derived classes. I can say extrusion is a feature with a sketch. So I can draw inferences from there to connect it to this one as well. So this way, you're starting to blend the two databases into a single logical structure where your queries can go across. You can have a query which can ask certain things and then you can actually extend it in such a way that you have get derived classes or derived representations.
There's a question.
Sure.
How do you verify such models?
Okay, first of all, there are certain completeness to the categorical model. You can ask certain questions because all the nodes are connected functionally, what you have is that you can create path equations. So if there are two nodes at each end connected through different set of nodes, you can make sure that each of these paths will provide the same result in both places. Okay, so you are basically, what you are doing is once you have created a category, you create another functor into the value space, which is to the set space, right? then you can ask queries and find out whether it is producing the right results or not. So that's how you verify. And you can also translate it into logic, and because it's translatable to first order logic, and do some of the
deterministically. This way, for every query of this sort, the answer should be the same. Is that what you mean?
If the same query, irrespective of the path I take, should have the same answer. Okay. If you want, I can show you later by hand. Yeah. I try to make it simpler. Yeah.
Do functors have direction?
What do you?
Yes,
they do have direction. Yes, they do have directions. I won't go into detail. There are something called adjoint functors, which are left adjoint and right adjoint. So you can go from different directions. The mapping may be different also. Okay. Now, let us say we want to build integrated vocabularies. What you do is you have P and Q, and then you just identify the overlap. When you do the overlap, actually, this becomes a combination, what is called a codomain, where P and Q, along with B, resolves all of your semantic differences between the two groups. Okay, the big idea here, I'll come to that later. Okay, so we can start building domain-specific vocabularies, but bottom-up. The formal definitions guide the implementation. Formal theorems guarantee correctness. Okay, so what you have in category theory is this powerful machinery which comes with all kinds of mathematical operators at the more abstract level, going across formalisms as well.
Yes, so when you're trying to integrate, let's say, these two systems to get something which is a little more, which represents both of them, there are many possible designs, perhaps, that one could come up with. Is there a notion of minimality so that...
What you're looking for is the intersection when you're combining. What is the intersecting region?
Okay.
And because of derived types, right, even if I ask a query in one place, I can go ask the query in the other one because I can derive what other things are related to this and ask the query of another database. So for example, in one database, let us say machining is listed as milling, buffering, etc. But in the other one, it's not only says milling, it says horizontal milling versus vertical milling, etc., etc. But these two can be integrated because I can say this milling is the same as this. So anytime I use any of the other terms, also can be through the derived data types, I can also access them. Make sense? Not really.
Not at all, because I think there are two types of milling that you mentioned here.
Yeah,
so how do you distinguish between the two when you have only one common?
That's right, because I'm combining these two databases, because this database has certain information and it is set up as milling. And here it is set up, say they are as
like type A milling, type B milling.
Exactly. So when I ask a question about milling, I not only bring milling data from here, I also bring milling data from here with the distinction. You're right, there may be missing information on this side, which doesn't say whether it is vertical milling or not. Okay. That you have to disambiguate separately. Because all you are making sure that the two structures are connected in such a way that you can extract information from both places, from a database point of view. On the other hand, if I'm talking about vertical milling and I need to convey that to somebody else who doesn't know about vertical milling, I could just use milling, right? I can go the other way by going to a higher level of abstraction to create the interplay. Okay. So this is the example you can see. Here there is shape, extrude, boss, extrude. This is one structure. And here I have another structure, extrusion, always has extrusion and has a feature as a parent. And then it's a feature. Now this is feature plus sketch form is a part of the feature. Now, I can combine these two things into a single space here using the map. Okay? So all of this become available to me when I query from the top, not just one side, but both of them,
I can extract it from it. Now, let's go to a slightly richer example. So it's called more general co-limits describe larger aggregation across bridges. So I have a bridge across P and Q, I have a bridge across Q and R, P and R, and I have a bridge across Q and P. I can construct this C. In category theory, there is something called commutativity, that is, this going from this path or this path, you will arrive at the same result. That's what is called path equation. Now, what you have are many path equations here. One from this side, one from this side. But you see, I don't have to combine all of them in a single way. I can build each one of them piece by piece. I can build the first one, and once I have that, I can combine with another one by creating another bridge. So I can incrementally actually combine all of these things in a systematic way.
But is there some kind of a rules on how you can build and incrementally combine those?
Yes, of course. In this case, this is the overlap part, just as I showed you in the previous case.
Right.
You have to ensure, identify what the overlap is.
The infimum, or whatever they call it, right? The minimum.
Yes, minimum. Because the most canonical, if you want to think
correct.
Of it, piece, which overlaps both of them,
okay.
It has to be here.
Okay.
See, I'm not going into all kinds of detail. There can be interesting things, right? Extrusion may have a more elaborate tree
right.
here. There it might have more
it's
elaborate
level,
tree here.
The level structure, essentially.
Yes.
It is a lattice.
Yes. Yeah, it's a lattice structure. Right. That is why programming languages are representable in category theory, because it can represent lattices and
yes.
type theory is lattice theory in some fashion. I mean, if you take denotational semantics and those things. Okay. What are the benefits of bridges? Bridges are typically smaller and simpler than upper ontologies. You can build them bottom up. And given the kind of problems you're going to face in CPS, there is not going to be a top-down universal standard for everything, then we need something else which provides us the glue. And this is where category theory comes into play. So bridge can also be across levels of abstraction. For example, you have certain terms here, certain other terms in the higher level of abstraction, there will be some common structures which can be connected. For example, if you take atomistic simulation of materials versus molecular simulation, a lot of the interatomic distance and various things which you can compute in the atomistic level can be used in the molecular scale. So I can take certain information that can be taken up to the higher level, and I can define these interactions very precisely. So co-limits will allow us to federate across bridges, supporting modularity and standardization. And one of the things we are attempting to do, I don't know how well we will succeed, is to see whether category theory can be used for standards representation. See, a lot of people use UML for standards representation these days. We're just finishing a paper where we show that UML has a lot of ambiguities in its semantics, and actually we can reduce the ambiguity using category theory of UML. We have created a mapping between UML and category theoretic structures to address that problem. That paper should be done in a month or two if any of you are interested again. Maintenance, grassroots development and harmonization. Let us say one database changes here. I just have to change one bridge and then all the rest get propagated in some fashion, because at each level you only have to take care of the bridges for each one. Range of applications, connect semantic models with database theory, with computation, dynamical systems. And we have a position paper on this I can send you. And we have argued why category theory could be a very useful way for systems engineering, which has multiple formalisms operating across different scales. There are lots of challenges. One is to achieve both syntactic and semantic interoperability. The second is multimodal ontologies. You're going to have microblogs, microimages, e-images, all kinds of different things which have to be brought together. and develop event ontologies for the case of specific ontologies, and could build it from there, develop test methods, and implement prototypes in this context.
So when you say interoperability, are you only referring to data interoperability, or are you also looking at control interoperability?
We are also looking at control interoperability.
For example, an application command translates to large set of atomic actions, or happens depending upon the context.
Yes.
That mapping needs to be defined.
Yes.
And it needs to be changed. We just presented a paper on that in World Forum on IoT on control interoperability.
Yeah.
We applied it to a building automation use case. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was asking the question whether it applies to control interoperability.
Yes, it does. In fact, one of the papers we are working on is process planning. Using semantic model categories, which falls into very similar
control.
We are moving towards that. All this effort is about 2 years old from scratch. We are slowly building this up. And there are very few people working on applying category theory. There's a group in Oxford who's been applying to natural language processing, Bob and so. And there is some John Byers from UCL.
I have written one paper using this for service modeling.
Yes.
Service and variant modeling.
Uh-huh.
So various different variants of services.
Yeah.
I use this category theory to represent that, and just with a small paper.
I would like to
get it. I send it.
So I can give you some references if you guys are interested, and can also give you some of the papers. Okay. The problem with composing systems is the interfaces may be the same, but if the underlying semantics is not the same, which is called compositionality, it's very important, because the sum of the parts is not the whole. So which means, how do you determine, deal with compositionality so that we can ensure that the system behaves the way when it is composed together? This is a tricky problem. So this is where we think we can contribute as well. I'm not going to go into the details, but we believe there are various pieces corresponding to the modeling requirements I talked about earlier, and the associated category theoretic construction. You can have free completion, semantic categories, forgetful functors. When I go from one category to another, I'm forgetting some things. So I know the interpretation is limited in this space, right? And so integration is a compositionality. Evolution takes place through what is called Khan extensions, which is how you integrate databases of different ways. There are rules associated with it. And co-limits allows you to create different modules and combine them in different ways. So you have achieved modularity and scalability. You can use functional programming on these structures, as well as then representation across scales with co-limits and functors.
So are there any implementations or tool sets or something available or software?
You just asked a million-dollar question. There is one tool called ESIC, which allows you to create categorical structures and translate it into a database structure. EASIK.
Okay.
However, for all the things I talked about, we don't have tools. This is what we are starting to build. We're starting to think about how to build these tools. Luckily, Marty Burns from NIST, whom Professor Bharadwaj knows, and others have developed a CPS framework in UML. Now we are starting to work with them to convert the entire CPS framework to category theoretic structures, so that we can reduce ambiguities that are inherent in UML structures. And that has just started. We have had a few discussions, and we are starting to actually look at what the physical space formalisms are, what the control space, what this is a long-term project.
Okay.
However, we are interested in having students who are willing to come and spend time at NIST to work on some of these problems. We can probably get students from here to come and spend a year or two even to do the do something of this sort with us. There are guest researchers available at NIST. And we are hoping that we had a workshop last year, and we are hoping that we can build a community around it, because we believe that if we build this, just like Mathematica, and some of you may remember Maxima, the original symbolic, that really took off to deal with mathematics in a very interesting way, to do proofs, all kinds of things. So we feel that if we can build a toolkit in category theory, we can address these things. But it's some distance away. First of all, we are quite desperate to build a tool with not all the complications of integration, but just to ensure that you are doing the modeling the best and as semantically clean and syntactically clean as possible. Because we think if we do that, that is the first step. You know? Always, if you, as they say, if you ask people to do annotate things, they usually don't. Or if you don't make people use the standards when right at the first time when they are doing the work, that is the best way. Going and retrofitting is a lot more expensive. So if you can create a what Spencer calls a hygiene in terms of how you do the modeling itself, that becomes itself a very valuable way to actually deal with things. So one of the things we are thinking about is, can we use, actually Gauguin from, he is not alive anymore, he argued that category theory could be a very good way of software specification requirements. Given that you can have a structure and you can have things like symmetrical monoidal categories which capture the process, you have structures which are going through the process that can be represented, thereby actually creating a way to do software specification. Well, we need to understand the landscape of application. Inclusion, we need to integrate human decision making with sensor-based systems. In smart cities, we need citizen sensing, physical sensing to create robust and resilient systems. We need standards and means to represent their semantics, and we need a rich, semantically rich language to integrate and interoperate devices, people, and systems to ensure composition and composability. And that's where we think category theory has a role. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Subrahmanian, for a really interesting talk. I'm sure some of us will go back and look at this category theory. We'll have a few questions now, and then we'll break for coffee where you can have some more. Yeah.
Yes.
Can I
ask a question which is probably naive because I don't know?
No, nothing is naive, believe me. I started from zero in category theory just 2.5 years ago. Slowly getting, I'm still not there, I'll be honest.
In this kind of modeling, the goal is to represent the dependencies in the system, but not really to simulate the system as such, or?
Also to simulate the system, I didn't show you. See, what you can do is this. I'll use the materials example, it will be the same everywhere. So here I have atomistic, micro, molecular microstructures, and let us say here, macrostructures. Right? If you know about macrostructure, you use finite element methods to analyze stress. In microstructure, you use what you call micrograins and relationship between micrograins, which is a different structure. In molecular structure, you use something called molecular dynamics, using something called density function theory. And atomistic also, you use atomistic models and atomistic interactions. If I want to design a material with certain properties, right, how do I do it? This affects this, this affects this, this affects this, but I don't have a single theory to do it. What can I do? I can create a categorical model here. I can create another one here. I can create another one here. I can create another one here. Right? Now what I can do is I can create functors between them. Now what I have done is around this simulation and keep this data, whatever data that is coming in is connected to use that there and run this simulation, and then I do this, and then I run this simulation. Because I have all of these things can correspond to a database structure, I can actually create a composite database of all of these things. Right? What you don't know is how these things interact. If I keep running several runs or several sequences of runs, over a period of time, I will know what affects what across these, and thereby actually create a model which goes across all
so
of these.
If you say create the model, then not only, so if you would specify the functor explicitly which currencies.
Yes, you have to do that. I can tell you, I did this without knowing category theory 25 years ago for ADB. I just created a conceptual model which I now when I look back, I realize actually I was imposing category theory without knowing it.
Because then we need category theory like a language, but I never think about explicit functor which would connect this.
Exactly.
So basically this is extensible also, right? I
mean, yeah, it's extensible.
You can even have multiple layers, you can grow the layers.
Yeah,
you can change the functors in between, then you can introduce one in the middle.
Yeah. Yeah.
But how do you check for like correctness? Is there a notion of correctness and consistency?
Okay. In this case, I cannot check correctness because you see, this is a different theory. I cannot create a single collapsible.
It is basically as correct as you make it. That's what you're saying, right?
That's what we do, right? As engineers, we run one tool, we do another tool, we go between them, and we have a model which we are correcting or connecting with each other in our head.
Okay.
Can I do that formally?
Because the reason I'm asking is that we are looking at in our task force, we have a smart city task force here in the group, and we are looking at a more a siloed, because given the fact that in Indian cities, all these departments are kind of silos, you know, transportation, water, power, and so on.
Yeah.
So we are trying to build separate vertical applications, model them, and then integrate them using a notion of a data model or a data ocean or whatever you call it.
Right.
So I think this has a very seems to be very consistent with
exactly
what you are saying.
Yes,
because we cannot afford to create monolithic models for our cities.
Absolutely, no problem can be solved that way, right? Especially large scale engineering problems. So you have. I'm taking the same thing to the city level, like you said, transportation, using event shop and other things. I think I'll circumscribe that.
Right.
I'll circumscribe that next one and so on. And then I'll look at the cross interaction because I don't, you see, any time you, I should go back. A political scientist called Eleanor Ostrom, who won the Nobel Prize a few years back. She did a lot of studies and she came and said centralized structures of managing natural resources don't work. What she called polycentric structures. The same notion of polycentric structures were discovered first by her and her husband when they studied Los Angeles city operations. Okay? And they maintained that polycentric structures are the ones which will work in cities, not a centralized structure. So I have borrowed that and borrowed from different places to say what we need are polycentric structures,
yes,
both in an informational sense and in a political as well institutional sense.
Actually, if you don't mind, we'll close the formal session because some people don't want to leave. And then we'll continue the discussion. We also have coffee outside, so let's have further discussion for coffee. Thank you.
Thank you.